We have a great turnout. Thank you very much for coming. My name is Brenda Labratz. I'm Commissioner of Community and Fire Service. And I thank you for coming. This is the first of three in a series related to trees, which is quite good from staff perspective because we're doing a workshop with our council on our tree process, our tree bylaws, etc. So it's always good to have experts come in and provide some support and raise our awareness and just share that with the public, our staff, and our community. So before we get started, I would like to thank Councillor Burke and Councillor Ho. If you could stand up both, and thank you so much for attending. Both good supporters of trees in our planning process and trees in our communities. I also would like to thank Tanya Lewenberg and Yvonne Young. Where is Yvonne? Yvonne, could you stand up? And Tanya? These two ladies are responsible for undertaking our public realm speaker series, which we've had going now for almost 3 years, maybe almost 4 years. And we've covered a variety of topics. And it's something that I really care about. I really love public realm because it's really animation and it's city building opportunities for us. And Tanya, it leads up, but we have a public realm office at our operations department and Tanya leads that. So thank you both for organizing this and your efforts on an ongoing basis. Greatly appreciate it. Now I have the honor to welcome our speaker for today. Our today's focus will be on the economic value of the urban forest. And we're very fortunate to have Ms. Karen Clarke-Whistler, the Chief Environment Officer at the TD Bank Group. Under Karen's leadership, TD became the first North American-based bank to be carbon neutral. That's pretty awesome. Learning from this program, we're leveraged to implement initiatives aimed at reducing energy use in the TD's business operations, developing a green building program, renewable financing products for residential and small business customers, and an innovative carbon offset program focused on partnerships with not-for-profit groups. And I think we need to find some out about that last one because I think it sounds very intriguing for our purposes here today. Working with TD Economics, Karen and her team have helped advance conversations around incorporating natural capital into business decisions and the value of our urban forests. In 2014, TD released two papers looking at the natural capital value of urban forests in Canada, titled Urban Forests, the Value of Trees in the City of Toronto, and the Value of Urban Forests in Cities Across Canada. Karen is an environmental scientist who is widely recognized as a thought leader in the environmental business matters. Prior to joining TD, she spent more than 15 years working as an environmental consultant to a diverse base of clients in North and South America, Europe, and Africa. So we're really pleased to have you today, Karen, and look forward to your remarks and giving an opportunity at the end maybe to ask some questions. So without further ado, thank you so much, Karen.
Thank you. Thank you. Well, it's great to be here today, and I thank you for coming. I thought, you know, it's March break, we're expecting a snowstorm. Maybe Tanya and I will be having a nice conversation with each other. So it's really great to see you all turn out, and also great to be in Markham. When I was in consulting, I worked on one of the first watershed studies in Markham, and that goes back over a good 25 years ago. So very amazing to see the development of the city over that period of time. But today, I am going to talk to you about this concept called natural capital. And I thought it would be a good concept to talk about because it is a very interesting blend of environment, economics, and accounting that I think is going to become increasingly important in urban planning decision making. And so I thought I'd give you a little bit of an overview of what it is, some of the work that we've done, some of the findings, and we could then take it from there with a discussion. So, you know, what is natural capital? And the short of it is, it's exactly what the title of my talk says. It's actually putting a dollar value on environmental systems. And so, you know, we're familiar with putting dollar values on different types of environmental resources, lumber, fisheries. That's a component of natural capital. But the thing that's different with our analysis that we have been working on over the past few years is there's an increasing recognition that these natural systems provide ecological services that in themselves have a very significant financial value. And that's a financial value that you will not find sitting on any balance sheet of any company or of any level of government. And as we can see in locations such as Markham, in all the big cities in Canada, we feel that this is a strategic management issue that we should understand better and that will give us a great tool as we have to make those hard decisions around economic development and environmental and social considerations. So that's a bit of an overview of today. And I guess I'll just start off with, you know, what are some of the key components of natural capital that we have considered? There are obviously lots of different components. There's recreational value. There's the just the pleasure value of being able to walk through, you know, a park. But for our work, we wanted to really focus on things that could have a good quantitative base that we feel we would need in decision making. So these our analyses are very conservative. They don't include all of those values I've just spoken about, but they do include some key environmental values that most municipalities would have the data to be able to quantify, and that we feel that there is good economic data out there to be able to put a financial value on. So the key areas that we're going to talk about as we talk about urban forests and natural capital are, one, the services provided by absorbing carbon dioxide, reducing CO2 levels. Second, the purification of the air through capturing of contaminants, producing oxygen. Three, and very importantly, the ability to absorb groundwater and to have an impact on increasing climate resilience. So those are the three areas that we have focused on putting value on. Okay, why did we decide to do this? Well, you know, to be perfectly honest, when we started, we were just being pretty selfish about it. Some of you may be familiar with our foundation, TD Friends of the Environment Foundation. We provide grants right across the country to grassroots environmental community initiatives. I think we've provided, I think there are 124 FEF grants in Markham over the past 10 years, worth about $1 million. And we wanted to find a way to start looking at the value of that, not just in terms of how many grants and how many dollars, but are we actually making a difference in environmental quality? So this is where, being the science person at the bank, I get to inject a little bit of geekism in there. So that's really how we started, but we very quickly realized that, you know, as we look across the country, certainly in the GTA, we're all faced with the fact that we are undergoing mass urbanization, that, you know, the population of the GTA is estimated to be about 10 million in about 20 years, less than 20 years. That's the current size of the city of London in the UK. And as I'm sure we all experience in our neighborhoods, there's that constant challenge of creating development opportunities to provide housing for people, but also maintaining an environment and a neighborhood where people want to live and enjoy the amenities. You know, Markham, I just looked up, you probably know better than me, but over 300,000 people, and honestly, last time I was here working, I think the Civic Center had just been built and it was in the middle of a field and there wasn't really anything around it. So, you know, rapid growth here. And so, you know, how do we balance this? You know, this is where you see a lot of community activism, either people not wanting parks or people wanting parks, people not wanting development or wanting development. So this is perhaps a tool that can help us a little bit as we have to make those tough decisions. So I'm going to talk a little bit, first of all, just about the first paper that we did, which was our kind of a testing ground on how to use this notion of natural capital in decision making. The notion has been around for quite some time in academia, and what was really missing from it was there was not the sort of economic rigor that you would see in a standard economic analysis, and we also didn't see the sort of approach that you would use in standard accounting practices. And we felt, you know, with our skills that we had within the bank of being able to bring all of those together and put them into a sort of a mainstream methodology, that could be very useful. So the first study on the City of Toronto, we looked at the value of the urban forests in Toronto. Toronto is a city of trees, over 10 million trees, and so that first component of natural capital value, which is literally what would happen if you cut them all down and use them for lumber, which you'd never do, but hey, we're economists. you know, we valued that at about $7 billion, and that's a pretty big number. But what was actually more surprising to us was that when we did that pretty conservative analysis of those ecosystem values, the air purification, the flood mitigation, the carbon capture, we found that that was providing over $80 million of services each and every year to the city. And those are services that if they were not provided, if you would cut those trees down, you would have to engineer. You would have to engineer flood resilience. You would have to put in air pollution control measures. So you have really working for you a value every single year of $80 million through these natural systems that also, of course, provide many other amenities. And then the other interest, and in the City of Toronto, which has quite a mature urban forest canopy, lots of those beautiful old trees, we found that of that $80 million, about $55 million a year was in reducing flooding. So given how we are all so concerned about climate adaptation and increasing resilience, you know, this is a huge tool that is acting for us already. And for those of you who have to manage budgets, the other interesting piece that we found was that for every dollar that we spent on maintenance, there was an over $3 return on investment in terms of the services provided. So that's pretty good. So that was the first paper, and it was kind of interesting. When we finished the paper, you know, being a bank, our corporate and public affairs people said, you know, that's great, but people aren't really going to be that interested in it. We're not going to make a big deal of it. We'll just put it out on our website. Well, it still is the most popular economic paper that TD Economics has ever put out. Now, we're not talking Pulp Fiction here, but we've had inquiries literally from around the world over this paper. And that really goes to show you the sort of appetite that there is out there, especially at a municipal level, but also at province and state levels around the world. So the other interesting thing, and so we were just talking about this a little bit earlier, you know, our urban forests are largely private. You know, if you look at Toronto, of those over 10 million trees, over 6 million of those are on private property. Now, I think, Brenda, you were just talking to me about tree bylaws, and I don't know exactly what you were, you know, the specifics, but this is really important. You know, the management of our urban forest canopy is largely in the hands of private property owners. And from that perspective, we have a great opportunity not only to educate, but to engage and to build in stewardship programs around this. I think the other interesting thing that, you know, it just makes common sense, but the natural capital value of an individual tree increases with time. It just makes sense. Bigger trees can capture more carbon, they can provide more shade, they have deeper root systems. So when we, that has two elements to it. We want to think pretty carefully when we do have mature trees about preserving them. And we also have to realize that from a strategic management perspective, you know, this is a very long-term proposition. Those trees that you are planting today are going to be around for 100 years, providing more and more and more value over that period of time. And so when we have extreme weather events, such as the ice storm that I hope we're all not going to have tomorrow, you know, which severely damaged over 20% of Toronto's urban forest canopy, or, you know, even more dramatically, the fires in Fort McMurray, which were the biggest insurance disaster in Canada, where the insurance costs were only a fraction of the natural capital value that was lost. So you really do have, you know, a very serious situation on your hands. And that just says you really have to be strategic about this, looking at what you have and thinking not only in the medium term but in the long term about what you want for future generations. And again, when you start putting the numbers on it and you can discount and all of that, you pretty quickly see that the best thing you can do today is plant trees. It's going to save your kids and grandkids a lot of money down the road. So having done that work in Toronto, and we thought that's kind of interesting, we thought let's look across the country and see, you know, is a forest, are they all the same? Do they have different types of amenities that are provided by different urban forests? So what's the deal? So we looked at urban forests in these three other cities across the country, and we found some interesting results there as well. And I won't go into all of the numbers here, but again, if you just look at the total replacement value of the trees in these four cities, that is a $60 billion natural resource sitting there, which on a yearly basis is providing over $350 million of environmental services across those four cities. And what's interesting, if you dive into the numbers a little bit, if you look at the columns, say, for Toronto and Montreal, and you read down those columns, you'll see that in Toronto and Montreal, the biggest value provided by the urban forests are wet weather flow. And that's the mitigation of flooding that I was speaking about. Why is that? Well, because Montreal and Toronto have old, established urban canopies, lots and lots of big trees. If you then go and you look at Halifax, what you'll see there is that the urban forest in Halifax is much more providing value around air quality and energy savings. Does anybody know the history of major events that have happened in Halifax over the last 100 or so years? Big fires. Half the city was wiped out. So the trees that you see now in Halifax, if you go there, are much smaller, much, much younger trees, growing much more quickly. So because their growth is so rapid, they're very quickly removing the pollutants and sequestering carbon because they are growing that much more rapidly. And then in Vancouver, which is, you know, has it all. I hate always saying that, but you know, in Vancouver you do have an amazing combination of both old growth forest and the newer forest, and so you really do have an amazing situation there. And you know, it's why it is one of the greenest cities in the world. The natural capital value of the forest, not just the green of the forest, is really helping Vancouver with that. So from our perspective, what we were able to see was we have a methodology. It seems to work. It seems to be providing us some interesting insight into specific situations with, obviously there's economics involved, so there's a lot of estimating, but really something that you can start off with some pretty simple data, which is really understanding that the trees that you have and some sense of the age of the trees that you have in your municipality. I'll just talk briefly about some additional work that we've done, which I think, again, in Markham, it's very relevant. We've had a program going for the last several years with the Nature Conservancy of Canada, where we've been focused on protecting critical forest habitat adjacent to large cities. So we've worked with them right across the country to protect more than 15 properties. This is an example of a Carolinian forest property that we've worked with NCC in protecting. And, the interesting analogy here is, something, for example, like the Greenbelt, and most of these forests are in similar positions relative to populations as our Greenbelt. These are also providing incredible natural capital value. This is estimated, old Carolinian forest is estimated, over $19,000 per hectare per year of natural capital value to downstream systems. So it's not just the urban forest, but it's that area around the cities, the urban fringe that we need to consider as well. So this is great. It's really fun doing this sort of work, certainly for me, but, do people actually care? And so we have been doing a fair bit of polling around the country over a period of time. What do people care about in their communities? And, one of the things that has risen to the top every single time is the value that people place on urban green spaces, not just the quantity, but the quality. Virtually every poll says we'd like more trees. Yeah, we like our recreational areas, but we want more trees. And by the way, councillors, they want more benches. but this is uniform right across the country that people, especially as we live in these more developed urban environments where there's an awful lot of pressure being put not only to develop green space, but more people using green space, this is something that we find people care about passionately. And it's so much so that for our Canada 150 project, we are protecting green spaces right across Canada with over 150 grants to 150 communities that are aligned to growing and enhancing urban green spaces. So just to conclude, I hope I've made a case to you that we need to manage our urban forests strategically. We need to consider putting a natural capital value to help us at least understand those types of benefits that are being provided by urban forests that are not currently being captured in traditional accounting. And hopefully as you develop your sustainability plan, this is something that you'll consider looking at. So I think I'll leave it there, and hopefully there are some good questions. Thanks.
Does anyone have any questions for Karen? Please.
What does tell me that that picture on the right is
the town? Oh. This is a concept development of a apartment tower in plan for Malaysia. So this is perhaps another way of increasing our urban forests, in dense.
Is that real?
I don't know if it's built now, but it's on the books, and this is probably a couple of years old, so I should follow up. It might well be built.
Okay.
Yeah.
There's a similar project that is built in Milan, actually.
Ah, okay.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
I would refer yourself and everybody here to a book that's just been recently published, and it was reviewed on TVO with Steve Paikin, the author, who's the head forester, the largest forest in Germany. It's called Life of Trees.
Oh, yes.
I think everybody here, if they're interested in this, they should read that book, because it's not just growing spotty, but trees interact with one another, and they're best planted as a species, and they all interact and support each other. And it's a fascinating read.
You won't be surprised to hear I was given it for Christmas, and it is an amazing book, and you know, I'd like to make a plug for our not-for-profit partner here, the Nature Conservancy of Canada, because they have been doing a series with us for the past few years called Why Forests Matter, and the professor, who I believe is from, I think she's from University of British Columbia, who is the woman referred to who talks about how trees actually communicate with each other through their leaves. It's just, or through their roots. It's just absolutely fascinating.
It's an eye-opener book.
Yeah. Yeah. Yes.
That reminds me, I was up in Whitehorse a couple of years back. My brother lives up there. And he was wanting to build a little studio for his wife. She's a quilter. And he wanted to cut down a tree. So he had an arborist come in and say, he wanted to cut down this tree and this tree. So, oh, no, you can't cut down that one, or that one. Mm-hmm. Why? He said, because the roots are holding each other up. Because they can't go down, they go out.
Right.
So they're actually holding on to each other. So we had to work around the trees.
And that's actually an important consideration, you know, as you're planning out urban plantings, you know, from a flood protection perspective. Those roots that are shallow and broad have a higher ability to protect from flooding than the ones that are narrow and deep. Yes, sir.
In a growing city such as Markham, we always need like houses and business offices and so on, right? So how do you balance between development and the urban forests?
Yeah, well, I don't know the answer for Markham, but I mean, it is one of the reasons that we thought this sort of analysis would be helpful, not just for looking at the value of, you know, what's there right now, but also for planning for the future. So I'll tell you an interesting application that we've helped with this is in the city of Toronto. There's a move to sell off a lot of the property associated with schoolyards. I don't know whether you would have that here, but it's a pretty hot topic in the city of Toronto. And you know, and so of course, development will provide the tax base. But using this sort of analysis, we can at least provide some data that says, well, look, you know, here's the value that's already being provided there. So this is one tool that could be helpful in decision making.
But probably not in Markham though, because lots of those are still like a merger land, say like a farm.
Yeah, but for future planning, yeah. For future planning. I mean, those trees that I see in the, you know, the young trees in Markham in 50 years are going to be much bigger, and you know, Markham will, you know, you'll now be in a different stage. So I think very useful for planning. Yes, sir.
Having taught statistics for about 20 years, and having a new government who actually uses them for a while, my question to you as an economist is that how do we take that particular environment and get a number for it with respect to one of your measurements? You have four ways of measuring things, mm-hmm. Water flow, etc. And you know, we need numbers.
Yeah.
And,
so.
And so I'm saying, how can you? There's such a variety of ecosystems. How can you say Carolina Forest, that's a 4.3, and something else is a 6.2 or something? Is there anything going on in that direction? I think you should be going in that direction to try and standardize it.
So, you know, the interesting thing that we found when we started looking for data and, you know, how to do estimation was there has been a lot of this work done in the past. Certainly the Canadian Forestry Service has done a lot of work. There was a pretty strong move towards this in a lot of the provincial accounts, which was stopped, but we now see that coming back again. So, and there's been a lot of work in academia. So That's why we've been conservative. You know, we're only trying to do analyses where we feel that we can get a decent data set. But people are now starting to collect it, and we actually have been working with Stats Canada now to reinstate that, help them reinstate that program. Yes.
I have another point that I just saw of my partner, Ed Zeidler's, spent years trying to convince the City of Toronto to stop destroying the Boulevard tree habitat. We call them Y trees. Instead of a beautiful crown, is a big empty space in the middle.
Yeah.
And the economics is actually less expensive to bury the services, all those overhead wires, than it would be to maintain the wires and save the trees. But it hasn't happened.
It's interesting. We have, you know, we have been pulled into some of those discussions with this tool. I think one of the challenges that I've heard is in the older parts of the city, in burying the cables with all the flooding that's going on right now is going to be a real challenge. But it is a perfect example of where we're hollowing out the trees, we're making them less robust because of the hydro wires. You know, it's kind of, both of those things are working against each other, really.
Well, I think monetarily it does save money to, in the everything in the long run, to have those trees all could have been saved. Most of them are, you know, really ruined now. Mm-hmm. It's too bad.
Yes.
How does the GTA compare from its urban forest against the rest of the world? And can you provide us an example where they're doing it well?
No, I haven't done that analysis. I know that that this New York City has looked at what we've done and are doing that same sort of analysis. But no, that's a great question. Looking at how we size up compared to you know, compared to other cities, my gut would tell me pretty well, because if you think about European cities, you know, being that much older, you do not get these large areas of, you don't get large lots where people can plant trees, but that would be a great study to do. Thanks. Yes?
So is your organization interest or company interested in advocating the tool to be used by like municipalities, et cetera, to get at that number?
I mean, I think it would be, you know, our objective was really to provide a tool that could be used by others. And, you know, in terms of resources, there are a couple of groups that include municipalities around this now. There's something called the Natural Capital Lab, which is being run by the Natural Step. And they have municipalities represented in there. And I believe it's the town of Gibson, BC, has used natural capital as a really strong basis for their urban planning, and I know they're involved in that project. And then there's another group called the Natural Capital Protocol. It's actually based out of Cambridge University in England, but its goal is to try to come up with a consistent protocol that can be applied to many different situations. And that's really important because, you know, when you start calculating these big numbers, you can imagine it's pretty easy to start throwing numbers at each other. So, you know, I think from our perspective, we wanted something that was robust, that, that, you know, could be used in standard business or government planning. So that protocol will help with that, too. Yes? That was you. Yeah?
Just as municipality, we have limited resources, and sometimes we have to choose, you know, what our priorities are. Mm-hmm. Would you recommend to policymakers that they put more effort into planting new trees or saving existing mature trees?
You know, I guess what I would say is, and I think you've actually done some of this work, you need to look at it strategically. I don't think it's one or the other. You know, you need to actually look at it as a strategic management issue. and make those decisions. And you know, in terms of resources, I can tell you one of the ways that we got started is we had an MBA student from York University come on our co-op program, spend 6 months doing some of the digging around for us. So you know, you can start with this analysis without a huge, you know, need for additional resources and that sort of thing.
Yes. Natural capital provides a lot of health benefits as well.
Yes.
I couldn't see any numbers.
No, we are looking at that right now. You know, there's obviously a link between the air quality and you know, diseases like asthma. It's a pretty heated area. There's a lot of debate around how those air quality numbers are actually being used to estimate illness levels.
Also, nature diversity in terms of dimension.
Yes, for sure. It's just that's very hard to value, and so again, you know, we wanted to start off in a very conservative way. We are just right now starting to see whether we can add a social component to this, but it's a bit early days for us. That's a great point. Yes.
I guess I'm puzzling over the large percentage you say that are in private holdings, and the query I've got is that how do you deal with succession? Because in a mature city, suddenly your forest pretty well matures all at the same time.
Yeah.
And I don't know if anyone's looking at how you can build on that before it's all cleared off and now you're dealing with little seedlings going in.
Yeah, no, well, I think you're just reinforcing the point that, you know, with Canada being such a young country, you know, a lot of our old growth has been, you know, it's either been there from the beginning or maybe was logged once and then planted. But I think, you know, we are now at a stage where in our cities we have to start thinking about this more strategically. So yes, I mean, in Toronto we're going to see we're already seeing a lot of that old canopy is dying. There was a very long period before people started really replanting. The replanting was with non-Indigenous species. You know, lesson learned. So this is a long-term deal, and you know, we can only do manage what we have, but we can certainly think differently about what the next 100 years might look like. Yes.
Could you please elaborate on the cooling effects of trees and the issues with heat island effect?
Yeah.
Because that's a very serious issue.
It is. And I mean, it's, you know, just from a common sense approach, trees provide shade and trees provide protection from wind. And so anybody in their backyard or front yard, if you have a big tree in your front yard, you know that it's going to be, that room's going to be cooler than the room at the back, which has the sun beating in it all day. And so you can actually do that calculation of the amount of temperature reduction, which in the summer is a savings on electricity, and in the winter is actually a savings on heating, because it protects from the wind. It can protect from the wind.
Can you comment, perhaps, on the international approach? It seems we're doing our part. At least we have that creative tension between development and forest and how to manage both in a creative way. My understanding is that there's significant deforestation going on in the world. Can you comment on that? Are we just a drop in the ocean, or is there some international consensus that the strategic management of forests is the way to go, as opposed to rampant deforestation?
Yeah, well, I mean, the whole issue of deforestation has been a big issue for the last 30 years. You know, we all heard about the Amazon and what's going on in Indonesia. Obviously, it's been a very big issue in Canada with our forestry sector. So, you know, this is something that's been up there for quite a long time, and it's always been development versus, you know, development versus protection. I think in a lot of countries now, they are getting that balance more in sync. But what we found when we started doing the work was how do you account for the fact that now, unlike 50 years ago, you know, certainly in Canada, 85% of us live in cities. So, you know, we have this great boreal area. We have done a lot of work, for example, in looking at how to protect and have sustainable development there. But the big action, not only in Canada, in the world, is mass urbanization. So this is where we feel this is where we feel a lot of work is needed.
One more question? Sure. I was thinking about the cost benefit analysis of my, if I have a tree in my yard and it's going almost gone. Is there, what's the best thing for me to place? So if the municipality wants me to replace that tree, then they would pay, what would the municipality want? Would they want me to just put up a spin little thing to get started, or something that's 5-10 feet high? Are analysis being done that way?
I don't know the answer to that. Everywhere is different. So we do, in New York City, we've been doing major tree planting programs with the city. And basically they've been looking, I mean, obviously planting bigger trees is a lot more expensive. So they've worked out a model where from a private perspective, they would be probably, they actually do some tree giveaways, would be having people plant smaller trees in their private property, and from a parks perspective would be looking to plant bigger trees.
We can help you with that. Our forestry staff program. We have actually formulas that we use, and the size and caliber based on species and based on where you would plant it. So we'd be happy to help you.
As far as we know.
Yeah. There's science to it.
Yes, absolutely. Great. Well, thanks all very much.
One more question, because it's something we deal with here. We have not only our growing municipality growing like from a development or subdivision, but we also have a lot of infill development that occurs. And there's always that tension between the infill. And so one of the questions that often gets posed is, you know, the value of maybe moving your site plan to save a tree versus cutting the tree down and planting how many trees to replace it. I know you've talked about the economic value of this, but from what you're saying, I guess what we're looking for is what can we use as a compelling argument for a resident to say, you know, removing this beautiful mature tree has this kind of value, and to your property, to you personally, not just to the world, the environmental world. So is there any numbers or any kind of formula or something that we should be thinking about when we're talking around, you know, maybe moving it slightly, your building, so that you can protect a tree, or when people are removing trees to build their infill houses, how many trees should they be replanting in order to, you know, replace that?
Yeah, I wish I had an answer for you. The closest I can say is there is some pretty interesting work being done on the value of sort of mature trees to property values. And I think if there are any real estate agents in the room, they'll totally know that if a house looks out onto a park, it will probably command a bit of a premium. But I think there is some interesting work going on in general about the value of trees to property values. I know there is in New York. I don't know if it goes right down to the individual property level.
Thank you very much, Karen.
Great, nice time to meet you.